Mike's gone and bought one of his all-time favourite cars, a beautiful, original 56-year-old Mark 1 Mini. It's not seen the outside world for nearly two decades, and with only 81 of these cars left on the roads, we're determined to revive this classic. You know, I love the idea of turning this great little non-runner into a daily driver, and that we're not just setting out to create a museum piece. Now, there's a whole host of work that needs to happen under here to tidy up this engine bay, but the first job is to fit two clutch cylinders. One should be on the end of this pipe here, next to the brake cylinder, and the other should be right down there, next to the clutch itself. I need to fit the new cylinders so that I can take the car for a test drive, which will allow me to work out what else I need to do to make it a reliable daily driver. When the driver presses the clutch pedal, the primary cylinder converts that force into hydraulic pressure, which then forces the secondary cylinder at the other end of the system to disengage the clutch from the flywheel. Nowadays, the reservoirs on these things are typically made of clear plastic, but because we're trying to rebuild this car in the most authentic way possible, I'm using a metal one, because that's how it would have looked when it was new. The problem is, though, once I drop this through the bulkhead in the engine bay, the pin that attaches this to the clutch pedal itself can only be got to from one of the most inaccessible points on the entire car. Our Mark 1's tiny compared to modern Minis. 80 centimetres shorter and 50 centimetres narrower than the latest three-door hatchback. Luckily, having worked on plenty of F1 cars, I'm used to negotiating tight spaces. There, got it. So this is the clutch's secondary cylinder. Only costs about 30 quid, but without one, this car's going nowhere. The secondary cylinder's fixed to the gearbox using two bolts. With both cylinders fitted, it's time to fill them up with clutch fluid and use a bleed kit to get all the air out of the system. Air pockets prevent the hydraulic system from functioning properly and make the clutch pedal feel spongy. It's a two-man job, so my mate and fellow mechanic Nathan lends a hand.
Okay, go on then, give it a press.
Pumping the clutch pedal up and down helps force out any air from the system.
And again.
Yep, down.
Lovely. Nice one. Thanks, mate.
And there we have it, the system's bled. With the clutch now installed, I can finally get behind the wheel and get to grips with what else I need to do to make our Mini worthy of modern roads.
Plus, it means I get to drive the car before Mike does. Now, that doesn't happen very often, and I'm pretty sure we'll annoy him just a little bit.
Oh, do you know what? I love it. Now, I start to understand why Mike fell in love with this thing. It's an amazing experience. I love it. Clutch feels good. The pedal's got no sponginess to it. It's firm, it's positive. It's going through the gears really easily. So that's a job well done. OK, time to test out those drum brakes. Whoa. Whoa. Now, I know drum brakes are not the most efficient things in the world, but this thing just pulled immediately over to the right-hand side. And that is one of the tendencies that drum brakes have. They tend to go out of balance, and that, as you just saw, can be dangerous. And I want someone to be able to use this every day. And to do that, I need to bring the brakes into the modern era. Whoa! Whoa!
The drum brake was invented in 1902 and was the preferred braking system for car manufacturers until the 1950s, when disc brake technology was adapted for car use after being pioneered in the aviation industry. By the 1980s, practically all cars were being manufactured with disc brakes.
The other problem with drums is that inside, these brake shoes are being forced against the outer edge of this drum when the driver hits the pedal, and that converts kinetic energy into heat energy. But that heat is constantly building up inside here, and under heavy braking, it can get so hot, it can even boil the fluid in the system or overheat the shoes themselves, and that will definitely grab your attention when you're behind the wheel when the braking capability of the car just disappears.
We want to embrace the originality of our iconic and extremely rare 1960s Mini, but enhance its weaker elements. Its tired out drum brakes are out of balance and prone to overheating. If we want our Mini to be worthy of today's roads, the challenge will be to modernise the entire braking system without upsetting the purists.
that overheating issue can be alleviated with disc brakes because the rotating disc is always in the airflow being cooled. And in fact, Minis from 1985 onwards had disc brakes on the front because a huge percentage of the car's overall braking capability is done on the front axle. So I think fitting disc brakes to our Mini is a safe and sensible option that won't negatively impact its personality. First, I need to completely remove the brake assembly. Remember to make sure you drain the fluid before you disconnect the brake line or you'll make a mess of your garage floor. Once the ball joints on the track rods have been knocked out, I can remove the brake shoes. And then the assembly itself. Next thing is to fit the CV, or constant velocity joint, to allow the drive shaft to transmit its power through to the front wheels. The Mini was actually one of the first cars to utilise a CV joint, which gave a smoother transfer of power than the old universal joint that preceded it, because it keeps a constant speed or constant velocity through all angles that the wheel turns at. The new CV joint is greased, then knocked into place, and I've also replaced the rubber boot to protect the bearings inside from the elements. Then I can slide the new disc brake hub into position. All the parts on this job weigh in at 422 pounds. So I'm fitting 7.5-inch discs to our Mini. Larger ones with a bigger surface area would give us more stopping power, but to be honest, these are going to be ample for our little daily driver. And on top of that, anything bigger would also mean increasing the wheel size, and that has the potential to dramatically change the appearance of our little 60s icon. Don't want to do that. Even with a brand new disc, it's important to give it a once-over with brake cleaner to remove any residual grease before then fitting the calipers and reassembly. Cleaner brakes equal more friction. A dab of copper grease on the back and edges of the brake pads will help stop brake squeal. Once the pads are fitted to the caliper, they're both ready to be installed.
I'm fitting two pot calipers here, which means they have two pistons inside the caliper to help transmit that stopping force when the driver hits the brake pedal. And that is pretty much it. I've just got to do the other side and then bleed the system, and then our 20th century Mini is well on its way to being ready for 21st century roads.
Click here to subscribe.